the paparazzi is now just part of modern life. This really did not begin to the extent that we know it today until the night Charles Lindbergh landed in Paris. And now, oh my God, the most handsome bachelor in the world has found the perfect bride. Well, this just made the story twice as good. So that when they went off on their honeymoon, which they did in great secrecy, great planning, but sure enough, after a few days, the press found out they were on a small boat. And sure enough, the press boats start circling their boat just to rock it, so they would have to come up on deck. I mean, there was no privacy in the lives of the Lindberghs.
I have gotten utterly bitter about it. I have no patience, no understanding, no sympathy with the people who stare and follow and giggle at us, who ask questions, crowd, want to know about our private life.
It's been said that no one could have been more ill-suited for fame than Charles Lindbergh, and that might be true, but it's probably more true about Anne. Intensely private and intensely introspective and kind of thrived on her interior life.
Anne had always kept a diary until she married Charles. She stopped because it might fall into the wrong hands, but she continued to write letters, many, many letters to her friends and family. She wrote about their flights through North and Central America, about house hunting, and about their baby, Charles A. Lindbergh Jr., born on Anne's 24th birthday, June 22, 1930. And she wrote about what moved her.
The other night I went to a concert alone because someone was playing César Franck's Prelude, Chorale, and Fugue. I am fascinated by it just now and won't be in 6 months, I suppose. You don't like it the first time you hear it. And then certain themes step out and you feel slowly the strength of them and the repetition of them and the pattern. And what a thrill when one day you realize that both themes are being played together at the end.
They had a young child. They were building a big new house in Hopewell, New Jersey. But no matter, Charles had a cause, aviation, and he enlisted Anne, who went willingly. She became a licensed pilot and radio operator. In 1931, the couple left Long Island on a flight that took them through Alaska and over the Bering Strait to Russia and Japan. Their goal was to map out new commercial air routes.
She was crew. She was critical. He could not have done that by himself. He certainly couldn't have done it in the spirit of St. Louis. And the aircraft that they used was a Lockheed Sirius seaplane with two cockpits, which is to be found with the spirit of St. Louis at the National Air and Space Museum.
Mother, it has been the strangest trip, terribly exciting and new. I feel as though I'd been gone for months. The other night, flying, I dreamt about the baby, and it was like another life. I couldn't believe I had one. I love to think of him with you. Along the coast of Siberia, we flew over jagged mountains, volcanic with glaciers on their sides. I didn't see much of the country because I was talking to St. Paul Island all the way, every half hour, and part of the time to a Russian station, and part of the time to SS President Cleveland. Charles shouted, "Here we are!" And I just had time to pull in the antenna and look out. This is a fretful letter. I'm afraid I'm rather wanting to be back with the baby now. But I can't fuss too much before Charles. It is such poor sportsmanship when this is a marvelous experience.
Their voyage came to a sudden end in China when word arrived that Anne's father had died. They traveled home immediately. Then, on March 1st, 1932, their year and a half old son was kidnapped, taken from his crib through an open window. For 10 weeks, the entire nation fixated on the search for the Lindbergh baby. Anne began to confide in her diary again, for the first time since getting married.